behind. There's also the ballot that replaces voice voting, which again, not, doesn't sound too significant, but this is ahead of its time. This is a way, of course, that political bosses have of controlling how people vote who are dependent upon them. The establishment of townships to replace county courts is another thing. Again, you say, boy, this is really strange. The stuff that we fight over. But the traditional unit of government in Virginia is the county court. The county court has administrative duties, it has taxing and dispersing powers, and has no audit. It's self-auditing. These people are not like current county commissioners. These people are appointed. They're not elected. They're appointed by the legislature, the people in the power structure. And so what you have is a guarantee block from top right down to the bottom that the people will be following the party line and protecting interests. This is why it's important to integrate from all Virginia behind slaveholder as the bedrock of the state's economy, political economy. And so that's what this is about, protecting that investment. So establishment of townships anyway is the first thing that happens in a new constitution. They get rid of the county court. There are political bosses, they elect people, they believe that townships, you see, are even smaller than counties. We have magisterial districts. Each magisterial district would have its own people. And you knew these people personally. And so it was felt you had, it was democratic, you had a say over what went on where you lived. There's also the free public schools. And this, again, it doesn't sound very exciting either, but the West Virginia Constitution compelled the legislature to provide, as soon as practical, a thorough and efficient system of free schools. Incidentally, this is the first state south of the Mason-Dixon line to do that. There are no public schools south of the Mason-Dixon line in this period. It's easy not to know or to forget. So this is a very democratic, open, progressive kinds of measures in the context of the circumstances and the time. There's also this issue of emancipation. Now, initially the Constitution ignored slavery, mostly because the delegates didn't want to undermine its chances for success in getting passed. Congress is like a swamp. Divisions are so major, and after all, we're at war over these things, in effect. And so Congress says, well, there are lots of people in the North who are not interested at all in abolishing slavery. And so these people don't know how their bill is going to be fair. And so they don't pass, they don't say a word about the emancipation of slaves. So that when it goes to Congress, and I'll come back to this in a second, it's required that they include and they will include emancipation amendment. But one point I want to make is no delegates at the Constitutional Convention creating a Constitution for West Virginia. No delegate at this convention defended slavery as positive good. That's the kind of phrase that was used. A positive good. That is to say, it was every Southerner felt compelled at this point to be able to defend slavery as a positive good to society and why society should be built on slavery. They did not feel right to that. Now, what they did have qualms about was the federal government's power to come in and say, your property that you paid for now is no longer your property. Usually it would be like taking your cow, taking your farm, taking any other property, and taking and selling your rights to it. And they didn't think that was appropriate. And this is, again, this is one, as opposed to people, more radical abolitionist period, who say, tough luck, you shouldn't have slaves anyway, you immoral pigs, you deserve what you get. Which is how they were probably afraid in a lot of the view. So they're conservative in that sense. They're very interested in property rights. Okay, the bill then, statehood bill, goes to Congress. It's usually submitted to the Senate Committee on Territories, where statehood bills go, and it's given to this reorganized Virginia Senator John Carlisle Hartsburg, who up to this point is there because Northwestern Virginians regard him as a solid, he's a leader in the statehood movement. And then he does something that was shocking, dismay, and puzzle all of his supporters, which is that he comes back with a statehood bill and a map of what state would look like that adds 15 more counties. All of them pro-slavery, lots of slaves in them, pro-secession, and adds the requirement that those counties have to ratify the statehood bill in order for it to become a state. And people in West Virginia, he was lucky he wasn't here. He probably would have been strung up. He was definitely persona non grata thereafter in West Virginia, until his death. Still lives here with people, you know, if you read the interpretation of Carlisle, you'll find that they were still all this against us. When the statehood bill reached the floor, though, it looks like this. And it becomes clear that this is a problem. It becomes clear to the abolitionists on the floor that this bill is not going to pass. Statehood will not come into existence unless there is an emancipation bill built into this bill. Senator Charles Sumner of Massachusetts tried to amend the bill to abolish slavery outright. And Waitman Willie of Morgantown is also a reorganized Virginia senator. He knows that people have qualms about this. They won't want this forced upon them because of the property issue. And so what he proposes as a substitute is a gradual emancipation amendment to the statehood bill, which is now known as the Willie Amendment. The Willie Amendment would have said 10 slave children 10 years old and under on July 4th, an interesting date to pick, 1863, would become free at 21. Those who were 10, over 10, under 21 would be freed at age 25. Those over 21 would remain vassals for life. That's what gradual emancipation, there are a number of states had gradual emancipation rules, and that's kind of what they did. The Senate adopted Willie's Amendment, left the boundaries of West Virginia as they were drawn by the Constitutional Convention. And then the Senate proceeded to pass it. The House passed the bill. There were fights and arguments. This was not an overwhelmingly approved thing. But they passed with some difficulty. When the West Virginia statehood bill reached President Lincoln's desk, he turned to his six cabinet members and asked their advice. And he asked them one question. Is the act constitutional and is the act expedient? Incidentally, expedient in this period means, it's like saying, is it good policy? This would say, is this practical? You know, is this something we can do? That's expedient, not some sleight of hand maneuvering, that we tend to use that as a word. Anyway, of course, twice in this period, this cabinet split, three for, three against. And Secretary of Treasury Salmon P. Chase summed up for the three who said yes. Chase argued that the West Virginia bill was constitutional because the majority of the members of Virginia's pre-war government had, who had remained loyal to the Union, approved statehood. And these are his words. It would have been as absurd as if, as it would have been impolitic to deny the large loyal population of Virginia the powers of a state government because men clothed with executive, legislative, and judicial powers had betrayed their trust and joined the rebellion against their own country. Okay, that's one side. And that's a view, and I pull this one out because it's a view that is widespread. There's another widespread view to this, though. And it's enunciated by Attorney General Bates, summed up the opinion for those who said no, it wasn't. The reorganized government of Virginia, he said, does not and never did, in fact, represent and govern more than a small fraction of the state. I consider this proceeding revolutionary, all the more wrong because it is needlessly begun at a moment when we are strained to the utmost in efforts to prevent a greater revolution. Many public officials express views both in Congress and on the press and on the street about views on the constitutionality of West Virginia statehood. One of the most interesting offers, without any sense of irony I might add, was that of President of the Confederate States of America, Jefferson Davis. This was his tale. When the State Convention of Richmond passed an ordinance of secession, the legally expressed decision of the majority was the true voice of the state. When, therefore, disorderly persons in the Northwestern County assembled and declared the ordinance of secession to be null and void, that was the first time the convention did that, they rose up against the authority of the state. The subsequent organization of the state of West Virginia, and its separation from the state of Virginia were acts of insurrection, revolution, and secession. To admit a state under such a government is entirely unauthorized, revolutionary, subversive of the Constitution, and destructive of the Union of States. A lot of people shook their heads, mostly in the North. Overcoming his doubts, Lincoln signed statehood bill, December 31, 1862, and he stated his reasons very clearly. On the issue of constitutionality, he noted that even though the actual number of people who voted for statehood was small, it is, and I quote, "It is not the qualified voters, but the qualified devotees who choose to vote that constitute the real power of the state." Virginia's non-voters were not merely neglectful of their rights under and duty to this government, but are also engaged in an open rebellion against it. On what must have been his major concern, Lincoln posed this question: can this government stand if it indulges constitutional constructions by which men in open rebellion against it are to be counted, man for man, the equals of those who maintain their loyalty to it? It is said the devil takes care of his own. Much more should the good spirit of the Constitution and the Union take care of its own. I think we cannot do less and live. Finally, Lincoln made his decision, declared it. It is said that the admission of West Virginia is secession, and tolerated only because it is our secession. Well, if we call it by that name, there is still difference enough between secession against the Constitution and secession in favor of the Constitution. I believe the admission of West Virginia into the Union is expedient. Lincoln approved the bill on the condition that West Virginians would approve the gradual emancipation amendment which they did in March 1863 by an overwhelming vote, 28,000 some to 592. And so the state of West Virginia became the 35th state on June 20, 1863. And some have been complaining about it ever since. The Civil War is one of those counterfactual historians really get tired of, because you can just go on and on. It does go on and on and on. And it has it totally out of the realm of fact. It did. It is, the Supreme Court had a chance to say, no, it is unconstitutional, and it did not. And so, what's there to say? Okay, except as, an intellectual exercise. The Civil War trapped West Virginians, though, West Virginia state makers, in a paradoxical circumstance, however democratic their intentions may have been. Their efforts played out, of course, under conditions which forced them to act in arbitrary, undemocratic ways to protect the new state under these wartime circumstances from residents of Southerners returning Confederates, for example, who identified with the other side in this conflict. The founders instituted undemocratic measures, for example, testos for voters, testos for teachers, lawyers, public officials, swearing on the Bible that you were always loyal to the Union and you never had a hand or had any, in some places, didn't even know anyone who was a Confederate. Some of them are taken, of course, to great lengths. After all, people are getting shocked over these issues, so you can imagine someone as many liberties as they can get away with to support, to bolster their side. There's also voter registration. It's just, some of these are like the segregation laws in the South, voter restrictions on blacks in the South. Like the voters registration laws that barred former Confederates from voting. And all you would have to do is have someone standing at the polls, somebody you don't like shows up or you're suspicious of. This guy said, oh yeah, I saw him before. He was with that Confederate. That's not, you're out. Somehow these are all Democrats. Right? And so this is a way the Republicans solidify their power. But it's also, that's the cynical view. The other part of this is that it's also protecting the government that they're trying to institute. In some of these counties, 80% of the population is disfranchised. So you can see this is not going to be a formula for good feelings. And there are other discriminatory acts as well. Under the circumstances, loyal unionists of West Virginia, circumstances of the war, they could have hardly done otherwise. But they could not acknowledge that achieving statehood, they had engineered really the only successful secession in American history. Since statehood was gained by force of arms, the defenders of the rule of law, state makers, could not admit that they had, in fact, led a revolution. Over the next 150 years, West Virginians tended to be defensive about the origins of their state. But reading that history indicates that they should be proud that West Virginia was created by high-minded founding fathers who led a revolution, and a revolution to advance democracy rather than one to conserve a slaveocracy.
Thank you. tomorrow, I don't know.
Now, why wait? End of now, not 20 years from now, while gravel acquisition makes the sense. And this is important in northern West Virginia, because northern West Virginia is essentially rural. We don't like to admit some because we don't like to view it that way. But it's settled by northerners, mid-Atlantic people, there are newspapers, this is easy to document, incidentally, a number of people, period, prominent people publicly say this. Even Confederate sympathizers writing back to leaders in Richmond say, look, all our newspapers are northern papers, all our preachers are trained in the north, all our business flows to the Ohio River and west and north. All of those influences. So all the reform, this is a reform era. This is what's called the era of reform, 30s and 40s. And one of them, there are many reforms, anti-slavery movement is one of them, liquor, all of these things, they're all moralistically based. And so, sure, they're influenced by this directly. And it's, their arguments are moralistic. As opposed to, and the ethos is not one that is moderated by commercial, which is a model. We know it's not. The world is full of them. Look, you get this, you have that, you have to give and take, you can buy. These people are not about that. They have nothing to do with it. And that's why there's an economic argument for it. Even the economic argument is tainted by the world's vision of what the proper society and economy should look like.
Yes. You had that one, I don't know, West Virginia geography, but you had that one blue spot in the west.
Yes, salt and coal, but the salt industry, a lot of industries are based on a plantation model. So that, they have slave quarters, some of the slaves work in the fields, buy food, some of the miners do dig coal, people work in the brine works. They can't be making their food, so it's a plantation model. The early iron industry was based on that. Coal mines were like that too. So yeah, it's part of that. But also, the Nile Valley is a wide kind of valley. It's maybe one of the few places in West Virginia that's appropriate for a plantation model. West Virginia, historian.
not the historian of West Virginia, to be.
Thank you. Birthday cake right around the corner on 75 First Street. You're in line to do that.
I think it's maybe the talk to the studio or whatever. Yeah, just kind of follow them.